Tonight we're in Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3, as we continue on Thursday nights through the book of Galatians. Paul, of course, had established churches in the area of Galatia. Remember, it's not a city, but rather an area. Really, they came to know the Lord. But there were those who would follow Paul really after he would leave a city. After he'd get it established, he would move on to another city. And they wanted to really capitalize after those believers and really take control. They were known as Judaizers. They would come up from Jerusalem, and they liked Christianity, but they didn't want to leave all their former life and what they have learned and their positions that they had. And so they loved control, and so they wanted to control people and how they should conduct services, the things that they would do, they couldn't do, and everything that would make them righteous before God, they thought would make them people righteous before God. They didn't really like the idea that where Paul said, by grace that you're saved through faith. He wrote that. He says, that not of yourself. It's a gift of God, lest any man should boast. They might say, grace is a gift of God, but you remember you gotta keep the Sabbath, you gotta do this, and by golly, you better wear your clothes right when you come to church, right? And you gotta look and act a certain way. We've all tasted that, we all seen that, and as Paul said as he opens up, oh foolish Galatian, who has bewitched you? You know, when I was reading that, I wanted to look at it through the eyes of those in Galatia. And here's Paul coming in, and he's calling me foolish. Can you imagine him showing up and calling us, oh, foolish people of Costa Mesa, oh, foolish ones who go to Agape Chapel? I think I'd get my dandruff up. In fact, I probably wouldn't like the guy saying that, and I would want to start duking with the guy. You know, who do you think you are calling us foolish? But then he says, who's bewitched you? Now he's getting personal, isn't he? He's starting to say that I've been confused. I've been misled. Bewitched is in a sense that I've been duped in a way to believe something. I've been conned, haven't I? To believe something that isn't true. I've been bewitched. Who has put the spell over you that you should not obey the truth? So the argument then now would come, and we would have to lay our cards on the table as we would have a conversation of what truth is. What is truth to you guys? What does truth mean? As he says, the truth, that you should not obey the truth, otherwise you're not going to listen to the truth, that you choose that your truth is more important than what the Bible says? Does your truth supersede what God says? And that, believe me, that's the way the world lives. The world lives in a place right now where they think they know better, don't they? They know better than what God says. And who are you to tell me this? You're being very judgmental, brother. You ever had that before? You know, and the Bible tells us, we'll get later on, that we need to, to expect the fruit, to see if people are bearing forth fruit that's pleasing to the Lord. He says that you should not obey the truth before whose eyes Jesus Christ had been evidently set forth, crucified among you, whose eyes you've seen, you witnessed the crucifixion, what he's saying. You're very much aware of it. Jesus, when he was crucified, wasn't taken out back someplace, but it was very public. Everybody could see it. Everybody was very much aware of the crucifixion that Jesus went through. He says, who are you? Who's bewitched you that you're trying to think that salvation's going to come in some other way? And Jesus, of course, he said in that fateful day, there in the garden, he says, Father, if there's any way that this cup can pass for me, if salvation can come from any other means, any other ways, then let this cup pass for me. the pain and the torture that he was about ready to face. And he says, nevertheless, what did he say? Not my will, but thy will be done. His willingness to go to the cross, because there was only one way that salvation was going to be brought to mankind, is because the Bible tells us without the shedding of what? Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. And it took the shed blood of somebody that was innocent, like that lamb, that perfect lamb, without spot, without blemish, in order to satisfy there on Passover day. And Jesus became that perfect sacrifice for my life. I look at my life right now and I'm as blessed as a man could get. You know, love doing what I'm doing. I'm loved that I'm here to be able to share the gospel. Been married well over 40 years. Have two wonderful kids that love Jesus. I have two grandkids now that, oh my goodness, life can't get any better than what I have. God's given me great health through prayer that I, you know, for a guy my age, I can't complain. I can't complain. You know, God has strengthened me because of the shed blood, because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ. He's given me, you know what he's given me? He's given me access to his throne each and every day. Each and every day, I can go run into my Father's lap and he doesn't say, you know, say, well, wait till you get your act together, does he? He just takes me like I am. And he says, come on up. Get on up. Tell me what you got going on today. Let's talk about it. And I love that. He says that before whose eyes Jesus Christ had been evidently set forth, crucified among you. Verse 2, this only, he said, would I learn of you. Receive ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? How did you receive the Spirit? Did you keep a bunch of ordinances? Did you keep everything that says in Deuteronomy? You ever read Deuteronomy? Try it out tonight for this week's reading assignment. Read the book over. Get across the Ten Commandments. And he says, did you keep all of them? Did you keep everything from your youth that you were able to keep them? Did you receive the Spirit by the keeping of the law? Or by the hearing of faith. I don't know about you guys. It was the hearing of faith. I heard heard about Jesus. And where does faith come from? The Bible tells us faith comes from hearing and hearing the Word of God. When Jesus started speaking to me, when that fateful day I started hearing his voice and he started wooing me to come to him, it produces faith in my heart. And I started saying yes to Jesus. And my faith grew. I'm 100% advocate, and I hope that you are too, that you spend time reading the Bible for yourself. Reading it and just meditating on God's word, because it does something. It's more than just a book. The Bible tells it's a living, sharper than what? Any two-edged sword. There hasn't been a weapon that's sharper than the Bible. It's able to get right down to the core of the matter of your heart and separate the flesh from the spirit. And I love the work of the Spirit within my life. There are groups today that feel that the gift of the Holy Spirit is some sort of reward. For holy living. You know, you receive the Holy Spirit if you live a certain way. You know, there's two camps, of course. Either it's a gift or something that you've earned. I receive the Holy Spirit because I read the Bible 10 times a day. Or else I give a certain amount of money. Or if I'm on, you know, I got a pew named after me. So thus, you can really tell I receive the Holy Spirit, right? I'm special before God. Well, let me tell you, we're all special before him. We know that the Holy Spirit is a reference to the gift of God. When you say the Holy Spirit is a gift of God, you know what it is? It's a gift. If you could earn it, it would no longer be a gift, would it? It would be something you could go out and obtain on your own strength. In verse 3, he says, are you so foolish? Don't you love Paul? Go walking in. Yeah, picture him walking into the coffee chapel, standing up right here, and him saying, are you guys so foolish? I think we would all want to start throwing tomatoes at the guy right now. I'd be ducking. Are you so foolish, Paul said. Having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect or complete by the flesh? And that's what they were doing. The cross wasn't enough for salvation. That's really sad, isn't it? When you read, as tonight as we were sharing in communion, one of the phrases that I love, as Michael's talked about the seven sayings of Jesus and what he said on the cross, one of the last words that happened, he cried, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. And as he was crying, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? At that very moment, they would like to say that the sins of the world came upon Jesus. He was who was sinless, became sin for us. In Psalm 22, it says that he cried out, it says, it is finished. What's finished? Everything that was needed for salvation was finished on the cross. He put an exclamation after the need for adding things. Are you so foolish? Excuse me. Paul said, having begun in the Spirit, are you made perfect in the flesh? You know, so sad, every genuine revival and move of God or move of God's Spirit in a group of people within a revival, every revival seems to begin with God, but it always seems to end with man. Man trying to perfect it, trying to, God who worked in the Spirit, they start saying, you know, we need to get organized. The things are getting out of control. They're too big. Things are moving too fast. We need to hire a consultant on how to figure this out, how we can reach more people. You know, things of the Spirit just happen, don't they? This is the problem with the foolish Galatians, having begun in the Spirit, trusted in Jesus for their salvation, trusting them for the faith in Christ. They counted by God for righteousness. They started adding things to how good they could become and how righteous they could become. In verse 4, he says, have you suffered so many things in vain, if it be yet in vain? They suffered persecution from the Jews. He says, from the world outside, because of their claim that Jesus Christ was the Lord and he was their promised Messiah, they were still wanting to say that. They suffered all persecution. They committed their lives as servants of Jesus Christ. They were brought into persecution in Rome. Rome had felt that if you had made allegiance to the lordship of Jesus Christ, you were really somehow now a traitor. You weren't bowing your knees to Rome. So thus, you know, they saw them that you had done wrong. And says, so they would suffer for it. Have you suffered these things in vain? But Paul said, if you suffered in vain, if it is in vain, he therefore of that, verse 5, he therefore that ministers to you the Spirit and worketh the miracles among you, does he by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Most commentaries believe this is probably referring to Paul's own ministry in the area there of Galatians. The marvelous ministry that God had given Paul, where the tremendous power that was working, the miracles that were happening through his life. Do you think this was happening by how good I am, Paul was saying, all the good, wonderful works that I'm doing? Paul was saying, no, it wasn't me. It was the work of the God's Spirit that was reaching people. You know, I think it's, the wisdom sometimes really is to know yourself, isn't it? To know your shortcomings. And Paul knew that he had faults. Read Romans chapter 7 about Paul. He says, the things I want to do, those are the things I don't do. The things I don't want to do, those are the things I do. You ever been there? You know? I, as I mentioned a couple of weeks ago, an old singer of Maranatha Music, they wrote a song in the lyrics is, Lord, I woke up this morning already sinning. I've been there. Before my feet hit the ground, I'm already complaining and grumbling and everything about the day. Rather than giving thanks unto the Lord, Paul was a man just like we were. And he struggled. And he was probably blown away to see the miracle that God was doing in their midst. Verse 6, even as Abraham believed God, it was accounted to him for righteousness. Now, he goes back to Abraham. And he goes back as a great example of somebody who believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. This goes back to the book of Genesis, chapter 15. In chapter 15, verse 6, it says, when Abraham believed God, and God accounted it to him for righteousness. What made him righteous before God? Was it Abraham's works? No. The fact that he believed God, that God was for him, he trusted God in most difficult situations. Did Abraham make some mistakes? Read Genesis. Yeah, he made a bunch of mistakes. But he believed in God's, I believe in God's grace and God's mercy upon his life. I looked at that each and every day. How about you? I thank God that God's mercies are new every day. Every morning as I wake up, I look to it and I believe in God's mercy and God's grace upon me to give me the strength for the day, to give me the energy today to go out to do the things that he gives me to do. That's why I have a story to tell. That's what I get to tell, is about God's great grace upon my life and God's mercy. When you go back to Genesis, it's interesting there that God accounted his faith for righteousness. It was after God told Abraham to look up to the stars-filled skies. Remember that? He says, look on up. Take a look at it. Look at the crystal clear skies. Well, we'd have to drive a little ways out there in the desert to see what Abraham saw. But when you look out, I remember about this time of year in Minnesota on a crystal clear night, you could see the stars bouncing off the snow. It would be lit up because so many stars were in that sky. It was just filled with it. He says, see, take a look up that. And he says, start counting all those stars up there. Of course, you couldn't do it. He says, so shall be your seed after you. There'll be more than number than what you could look up there, old Abraham, because you simply believed in me. As you believe in him here tonight, you know, God's going to not only reward you today, but for eternity. That's pretty cool, isn't he? He's thinking about my tomorrow. And he's thinking about a year from now, 10 years from now, 50 years from now, 1,000, and for eons down the road. And he wants to show his blessings upon you. Simply believing in the Messiah. God accounted his faith, Abraham's faith, for righteousness. Verse 7, so Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for his faith for righteousness. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. Are you of faith here tonight? Do you believe in God? He says, then you're kin to Abraham. You're part of the same promise. Abraham became a father, not so much as a fleshly seed. For the scripture said in Romans 9:6, not all who are of Israel are of Israel. You know, not everybody who says they're Christians are Christians, are they? Not everybody who says they're a Jew are truly Israeli, are part of the stock. He says, not all Jews who say they're Jews, Abraham became the father of those who believe in God in faith. That's what he's talking about. Those who believed in God, those who would follow after God, so are the children of Israel. As he goes on in verse 8, for the scriptures, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith. The heathen, of course, is anybody that's a non-Jew. Does the Old Testament speak about us? Absolutely, right here. In Genesis 12:3, it says that we would be justified, that God would justify the heathen through faith, that we would be have a means to be able to have fellowship with God. He says, preach before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all the nations be blessed. You look at your globe, if you have a world globe, and you spin it around, and you look at this promise of this verse. And you know what blesses every person who's ever walked on the face of this planet is the person of Jesus Christ. And all of you, the nations of the world, will be blessed. God foreseen Abraham that one day this would be fulfilled through his line, which would be the person of Jesus Christ. And verse 9, so then they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. Galatians were basically, like I mentioned earlier, Gentile believers. And thus the blessings that are of faith, they are blessed of Abraham. And Paul goes on to declare in verse 10, for as many as are of the works of the law are underneath the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continues not in all things which are written in the books of the law to do them. That is the rules, or by the law, seeking to be justified by God, then you're placed underneath the curse of the law. Because in the law is written in Deuteronomy chapter 27, verse 26, he says, cursed is everyone who continues not in all the things. If you say, well, I did pretty good on most of them, it doesn't count, does it? Deuteronomy 27, verse 26, it says, if you don't continue in, it's going to happen throughout your life. I was good this past week, but I had a rough day yesterday. You know, they don't get a pass on that, do they? Because you can become guilty of the law. He says, of all these things which are written in the book of law to do them. He says that God had given them, he's passed down their Deuteronomy, the things that we need to do in order to be right before God. And if you violated them once any of the commandments, you would be guilty. You would fall under them. James said in the book of James, if you keep the whole law and yet violate at one point, you're guilty of all. Because the law says, cursed is the man that doesn't continue in the whole law to do all the things that are written thereon. So as I look at this, and I look at my own life, I would look at myself outside the possibility of eternity with Christ. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and I would have to raise my hand and say, that's me. And the Bible says, for the wages of sin is what? Is death. But I'm so glad that's not the end of the verse, aren't you? He says, but the free gift of God is eternal life unto those who keep the law? No. Or those who do a lot of good works, a lot of charitable giving? No. He says, unto those who believe. Believe in what? Isn't that the question here tonight? Believe in a man? Men will always disappoint you. Believe in a church. Believe me, folks, churches come and go. There's more churches closing right now in the United States that are opening. That's a sad statement. People disappoint, but God never does. If we put our faith in Jesus Christ, he says, we have eternal life. And I pray that tonight that you would just simply, in all of our hearts, say yes to Jesus here tonight. And if you're watching online and if you've been in doubt for that, you just simply say, I want to believe. I want eternal life for my life. And by faith, if you receive it, it's yours. And the Bible says no man can take that away from you, eternal life. Why? Because God gave it to you. And God's not a man that he should lie. When he gives something, he doesn't take it back. In verse 11, he says, but that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it is evident, for the just shall live by what? The just shall live by faith. And again, it's faith. And this is the problem that I have with a lot of our Pentecostal friends. They put faith in faith. they put faith in, you got to have enough, you know, the problem you have in brothers, you just don't have enough faith. You know, you just, if you just give a little bit, then God's going to honor your faith by giving a little bit more. Just give some more. If you give a larger amount, God's going to bless you greatly. And they start playing on your carnal nature and your carnal mind, and you start feeling guilty. And you think, oh, if I just would do this, and then I'll get that. See, it's not faith and faith. It's, like I said earlier, it's not faith in a person, but it's faith in a faithful God. A couple years before I got married, I was a bachelor for a little while. While I was waiting for my wife to grow up, she was that much younger than me until I could ask her to marry me. And she's 7 years younger than me, so I'm blessed for that here tonight. But I remember for a couple years, I'd be studying my Bible after I get home late at night, and I had my Bible open, and I just felt the Lord take me back to the book of Habakkuk. And I go, oh, no, not this again, Lord. What are you trying to teach me? What are you trying to? It's only three chapters. Habakkuk is not very long. And it's a story about this wicked nation, the Chaldeans, who were the forerunners to the Babylonians, and how God was going to bring them against Israel, against his people. And he knew that Israel was having trouble. And in fact, he started arguing with God. You know, it's never a good thing to argue with God because you'll never win. He says, I know, Lord, that we're wicked, but they're far more wicked than us. And in chapter 2, it says that the Lord took him into a high tower. I think it's kind of like the Lord took him out to the woodshed out back to have a talk with him. And basically what it says, the spirit that's in you, it's upright in you, the pride that you have, it's not right, Habakkuk. He said, the just shall live by faith. And I would go, you know, month after month, I said, yeah, Lord, I know what it says. The just shall live by faith. And then one night, I said, the just shall live by faith. And then I heard this still small voice say, faith in who? I says, oh, the light bulbs came on. Faith in the God of all gods. The faith of the God of the Bible. The faith in Jesus Christ. And it changed my life completely. Because as if you get into chapter 3 of the book of Habakkuk, and the beautiful thing, even though problems were still around him, he's living in this world, but he's not of it, right? And the Chaldeans were still coming. His nation was messed up. Kind of sounds like us here today, doesn't it? He cries out, he says, yeah, you know, though the fig trees don't blossom, the fields don't yield their fruit. He says, that's okay, Lord, because you made my feet like hinds' feet and you set me upon hinds' places. You allow me to run and leap and jump and praise God no matter what's going on. He's able to take our spirit from the deepest despair, the deepest agony that we're able to go, that we might be going through. And he brings us to the place of faith. He says that, as we saw in verse 14, the blessings of Abraham might come unto the Gentiles through Jesus Christ. The blessings of Abraham, it came upon the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit. How? Through faith. And so that's really, I think, the message here on here tonight. In verse 15, as we kind of wrap it up, and we won't finish the chapter tonight. But, brethren, let me give you, he says, from a human illustration. And I love it where Paul kind of sits down with them now. He says, I speak after the manner of men. Let me just give you a human illustration here, though it be a man's covenant. Yet if it be confirmed, no man's disannuls or added thereon. What's he talking about? When you give a last will and testament and you die, that comes into force And in fact, nobody can change it at that time, can it? Because it's your last will and testament. And here's he using an illustration of a covenant, a testament that a man has made, Jesus Christ. As we celebrate communion here tonight, what does Paul says? He's given us a new covenant. And what's the covenant of? But the covenant of his blood. Well, that's what really put it in the force. That's what put it in the place, was the shedding of his blood. He says, this is the new covenant that Jesus has made for you. It's a covenant of a love that he made through the cross of Calvary. It's a covenant of a commitment that he, how much he loves you. And he won't change. No man can change this covenant. They tried, haven't they? They tried many, many times, and they still will try. They'll add to it. They'll try to take away from it. But praise God that our lives have been finished and complete through the cross of Calvary. That we stand, this blows me away, that I stand complete before the throne of God even right now. That I stand and you stand here tonight as we close here in prayer here in a moment, that we get to go boldly before the throne of grace to find mercy and to find help in the time of need. That we can go before God's throne. When you go to church? Yes. But I do it when I'm driving a car. I find that's a lot of time my best prayer closet is in a car, because I shut my radio off. There's nothing worthwhile to listen to, right? I use it as my prayer closet. When I'm walking, whenever I get my mind slowed down a little bit from the bombardment of things that come running through my brain, and I hear the voice of God, and then I find myself, I can enter into the throne of God. Paul was so wise. You know, that men should always, or the Bible says men should always pray, not to what? Faint. That we should pray without ceasing, what the one I was trying to get to, what Paul said. Would to God that we would be men and women that heeded that advice here tonight. Father, we thank you. Lord, as we just dove into a few verses here in the beautiful book of Galatians, Paul was such a radical, he didn't care. He went into that community that where he ministered before, and he saw people were being ripped off from the grace of God. I think it irked him. He stood up there in boldness and said things that need to be said, even if they were uncomfortable. He spoke the truth in love. And Lord, I know not only did it bear fruit within that community, it's still bearing fruit here tonight around the world as men and women are studying this book and learning, Lord, that we would take to heart that we that began in the spirit, we can't be perfected in the flesh. I know there's always a battle for the flesh wants to rule, the flesh wants to run the day. Help us to walk in the spirit, even this night and this week, Lord, that we won't fulfill the lusts of the flesh, our desires, being on first and being on top of things and having my way, but rather we'll just simply say, Lord, thy will be done here upon earth, even as this is in heaven, that we'll submit ourselves to your will. Lord, I just pray that for anybody that's discouraged, anybody who's cast down, Lord, that you might speak to them and remind them it's not by our works, but rather the work of Calvary, that we stand before you anyway. Even as the Bible says that even while I was yet a sinner, Christ died for me. Thank you for that great love. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't we all stand as Michael closes us in a song?